All right, so having gone through that exercise, Michael, I think it's worthwhile to step back a little bit and think about the assumptions that we've been making that have been mostly unspoken. And I'm going to say that the main assumption that we've been making in some sense boils down to a single word, and that word is stationarity. Mm. So let me tell you what I mean by that and why, by kind of illustrating what it is we've been sort of doing for a little while. Okay?
Sure.
Okay. So the first thing I'm going to say is that we've actually been kind of assuming infinite horizons. So what do I mean by that? When we think about the last grid world that we were playing with, we basically said, well, you know, I want to avoid going to the end as quickly as possible if I have rewards of a certain value or whatever, because, you know, the game doesn't end until I get to an absorbing state. Well, that sort of implies that you basically can live forever, that you have an infinite time horizon to work with. Now, can you imagine why, if you didn't have an infinite time horizon to work with, you might end up doing something very different?
Different than what we were doing in the grid world.
Right. So here, let me show you the game that we were the grid world that we were doing before. Might help you to think about it. So here's the grid world we had before. And as you'll recall, we had a particular policy that sort of made sense. Here, I'll write it out for you again. And this was with a case where we had a reward of minus 0.04. Remember? We just did this. Remember?
Yep.
Okay. And this was the policy that turned out to be optimal. And the feature I want you to pay attention to here is that when you're over right here near possible end state, rather than going up, it made sense to take the long way around because you were going to get some negative reward, but it's a small enough negative reward compared to where you might end up, okay, with a positive one.
Yeah, I see.
And that makes some sense. Well, that only makes sense if you're going to be living long enough that you can afford to take the long route around. What if I told you only had, say, 3 time steps left, and then the game is going to end no matter where you end up?
Well, it might make more sense to take some risk and to just try to take the short way, because otherwise there's really no chance you're going to get to the plus one. I'm not entirely convinced of that, though, because there's still a chance that you'd fall into the minus one along the way.
Right. So the exact value, whether it makes sense to take the risk or not, is going to depend upon 2 things. We've already talked about one of them, which is the actual reward that you get. If this reward were, you know, negative enough, then clearly it makes sense to just try to end things quickly, right? We just showed that in the last quiz. But the other thing it's going to depend upon is how much time you have in order to get to where you're going. If you've only got 1 or 2 time steps before everything's going to end, you can imagine that there are cases where, without changing the reward too much, it makes a lot of sense to try to go ahead and quickly get to this plus one, even though you have some chance of falling into the minus one, as opposed to trying to move away where you're then kind of all but guaranteed that you're never going to reach the plus one. So whether it makes sense to take the risk or not will depend upon the reward, but it's also going to depend upon whether you have an infinite amount of time to get to where you want to get to, or whether you have a finite amount of time. And the real major thing that I want you to get out of that is that if you don't have an infinite horizon, but you have a finite horizon, then 2 things happen. One is the policy might change because things might end. But secondly, and more importantly, the policy will change or can change even though you're in the same state. So if I told you, if you're in this state right here, and I told you you didn't have an infinite amount of time, but you still had 100 million time steps, then I think it's clear that it still makes sense to go the long way around, right?
Yeah, I mean, the probability that this policy is going to last for 1 million time steps has got to be tiny.
Right, so I might as well, it's 100 million time steps might as well be infinity. But if I make that number not 100 million, but I make it 2 or 3 or 4, then suddenly your calculus might change. And in particular, your calculus will change even though I'm in the same state, right? So maybe this state right here, if I've got 100 million time steps, I still want to go the long way around. But if I've only got a few time steps, the only way I'm going to ever have a chance of getting positive reward is to go this way. Does that make sense?
I guess so. So you're saying, for example, even within a single run, it could be that I'm in a state and I try an action, and maybe it doesn't work, and I stay where I am. And I try it again, and maybe it doesn't work, and I stay where I am. It might then switch to a different action, not because the other one wasn't working, but because it's now running out of time.
Right, exactly. So we talked about this notion of a policy which maps states to actions, and we talked about this notion of stationarity. So you believe that in this sort of Markovian thing said, well, it doesn't matter where I've been, it only matters where I am. And so if I'm in this state, since it only matters where I am, I'm always going to want to take the same action. Well, that's only true in this kind of infinite horizon case. If you're in a finite horizon case, and that finite horizon, of course, is going to keep counting down every time you take a step, well, then suddenly, depending upon the time step that's left, you might take a different action. So we could write that, I think, just for the sake of kind of seeing it as something like your policy is a function of both the state you're in and the time step you're in. Mm. And that might lead you to a different set of actions. So this is important. This is important. I mean, we are not, for this course, going to talk about this case at all, where you're in a finite horizon. But I think it's important to understand that without this infinite horizon assumption here, you lose this notion of stationarity in your policies. Okay?
Yeah, interesting.
Okay. So that, I think, is, you know, maybe not something that's obvious, but becomes obvious after someone points it out to you. So the second thing that I want to talk about, I think, is a little bit more subtle, and that's this notion of utility of sequences. So as we've been talking, Michael, we have been sort of implicitly discussing not just the rewards we get in a single state, but the rewards that we get through sequences of states that we take. And so I just want to point out a little fact that that comes from that and where that ends up leading us, and then we'll get to some nice little cute series of math. So here's what I want to point out, what we mean by utility of sequences. It means we have some function, I'm going to call u for utility, over the state, the sequence, sorry, of states that we're going to see. Let's call them S0, S1, S2, and so on and so forth. Well, I think an assumption that we've been making, even if we haven't been very explicit about it, is that if we had two sequences of states, S0, S1, S2, dot, 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 and a different sequence, S0, then S1 prime and S2 prime, that is two sequences that might differ from S1 on, but all start in the same start state, okay? If we have a utility for the first, and that utility happens to be greater than the utility for the second, then it also turns out that we believe that the utility for S1, S2, dot, 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 is greater than the utility for S1 prime, S2 prime, dot, dot, dot.
All right, so these are two different sequences. S1, the S's and the S primes are two different sequences.
Yes.
And in the beginning, we're comparing them with S0 stuck in front of both of them.
Yes.
And we're saying, if I'd prefer the S0 followed by all the S's to S0 followed by the S primes, then I have that same preference even with those S0s missing.
Right. And so this is called stationarity of preferences. And another way of saying it is that if I prefer one sequence of states today over another sequence of states, then I prefer that sequence of states over the same sequence of states tomorrow.
So isn't this just obvious? Because whatever the rewards are for those two cases, we're just adding the reward that we get for S0. So it's going to be the same.
Ah, but listen to what you just said. You just said, well, it'll be the same because all we're doing is adding the reward for S0. But what did we ever say about adding up rewards?
I thought that's what we were doing.
That's right. That is what we were doing. But we never actually sat down and wrote that down and said, this is what it means to talk about the utility of a sequence of states as opposed to the reward that you get in one state.
Okay, so you're saying that if we are adding rewards, then this follows.
Right.
Okay.
And then I'm actually even saying something even stronger, which is, I will show you on the next slide, which is, if you believe that this is true, that the utility of one sequence of states is greater than the utility of another sequence of states, both today and tomorrow, then it actually forces you to do some variation of what you said, which is just adding sequences of states, or adding the rewards of the sequence of states that we see.
Ah, that's really interesting. So the adding isn't really an arbitrary thing. It follows from this deeper assumption.
Right. And, you know, the reason I bring this up is because it would make sense if you were just to grab someone off the street and start talking about Markov decision processes. One of two things would happen. Either they'd run screaming from you like you're a crazy person, or they would sit and they would listen. And if they listened, they would just completely buy into the idea that you just add up sequences of rewards that you see as a way of talking about how good the states are, because that's a very natural thing to do. But it turns out that mathematically, that if you have this notion of sort of stationarity of preferences and this sort of infinite horizon world, you really are in a case where this has to be true. And it has to be the case that you have to do some form of addition, because nothing else sort of can be guaranteed to maintain this property over stationary preferences. I mean, as you said, if I got one sequence of states and another sequence of states, and by just prepending or appending another set of states to it, I'm still going to always guarantee that one's greater than the other. You kind of have to do some form of adding the reward that you see in those states in both cases. Because if you don't do that, then eventually this inequality will not hold. So let me write that down in math terms and see where it gets us, okay?